Good morning, and can the presenter start?
Good morning, ma'am.
Would like it.
Good morning.
Fitra, you can start.
Yes, ma'am. Patient name Mrs. Fitra, 40 years old from Egmore, housewife. Ma'am, can you hear me?
Hold on for a minute. Looks highly infected. Everybody speaks to me. Okay. Anything where I can hear properly. Start, ma'am. Pavitra?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Mrs. Chitra, 40 years old, female, a resident of Egmore, housewife by occupation, belonging to socioeconomic class 3, para 2, life 2, came to OPD with chief complaints of pain in the lower abdomen for last 3 months, swelling in the lower abdomen for 1.5 months. On elaborating, the patient complains of pain in the lower abdomen at the midline, just below the navel, for 3 months. It is insidious in onset, progressive in nature, dull aching in character.
Yes. Yes, a bit of paper. Not able to do this.
Ma'am, is it visible, ma'am?
No, you're audible, but it's not visible.
Is it visible now, ma'am?
No, ma'am. It's audible, but I'm not able to see her slide, right? That's the problem. Yes, ma'am, now it is seen.
On elaborating the complaints, the patient complains of pain in lower abdomen at the midline, just below the navel, for 3 months. It is insidious in onset, progressive in nature, dull aching in character. It was relieved on occasional over-the-counter medication and aggravated on physical activity, the pain radiates to the back. There is no diurnal or postural variation of the pain, and it was not related to menstruation. The patient also complains of a swelling felt in the right lower abdomen for 1.5 months. It is insidious in onset, progressive in nature. The size of the lump does not vary with cough, posture, or on strain. There is history of constipation for the last 1.5 months. It is intermittent and relieved by laxatives. The consistency as to the color of the skin is normal. No history of profuse menstrual bleeding. No history of lethargy, palpitation. No history of irregular bleeding, TB. No history of increased frequency of menstruation. No history of vaginal discharge. No history of loss of weight and appetite. Menstrual history. Patient attained menarche at 14 years of age. Regular cycle of 3 days or 28 days. Last menstrual period was on 21-7-21. She has moderate and regular flow of bleeding, that's per day. Not associated with pain. No clots passed along with menstruation. Marital history, married at 20 years, non-consanguineous marriage. Obstetric history, para 2, life 2. Last childbirth, normal delivery 14 years back. Both children are healthy. Family planning is done. Past history, no history of similar symptoms in the past. No history of diabetes, hypertension, asthma, epilepsy, or TB. No history of blood transfusion. No history of treatment for ovulation induction. No history of previous surgery. Family history. No history of similar complaints in the mother and sister. No history of malignancies like ovarian, colon, prostate, uterine, pancreas, breast, etc. in family. Personal history. Consumes mixed diet. No sleep disturbances. No history of tobacco and alcohol intake. No history of working in asbestos factory. General examination. Patient is moderately built and nourished. Pale are present. No ictus, no cyanosis. Yes,
ma'am? No, nothing, ma'am. Continue.
No cyanosis, no clubbing, no pedal edema. No significant generalized and supraclavicular lymphadenopathy. Vitals, pulse 75 per minute. Blood pressure 120 by 180 millimeters of mercury. Respiratory rate 17 per minute. Temperature afebrile. Height 155 centimeter. Weight 52 kgs. BMI 21.25. Breast, spine, and thyroid examination normal. Respiratory system examination, normal vesicular breath sounds heard. No added sounds. Cardiovascular system, S1, S2 heard. No murmurs heard. Central nervous system, no focal neurological deficit. On abdominal examination, on inspection, localized distension observed in right iliac fossa, superiorly up to para-umbilical region, lower border not appreciated, of size 11 into 8 centimeter, elliptical in shape, skin over the swelling is normal, doesn't move with respiration, doesn't increase in size on coughing or straining. Flanks are free, all quadrants move equally with respiration, umbilicus slightly displaced towards right, no sinus or dilated veins seen over the skin. On palpation, unilateral cystic tense swelling, no warmth and tenderness, smooth surface, border superiorly and laterally well defined, no pulsatility, compressibility or reducibility absent, fixity to skin is absent, mobility present, no organomegaly, no ascites. On percussion, dullness over the swelling is found. On auscultation, normal bowel sounds heard. Gynecological examination, external genitalia normal. Summary, ma'am.
Yes.
Mrs. Chitra, 40 years old, para 2, life 2, coming from ECMO, belonging to socioeconomic class 3, came with complaints of pain in the abdomen for last 3 months and swelling in the lower abdomen for 1.5 months, which was associated with constipation. On examination, 11 into 8 centimeters, smooth cystic swelling is found in the right iliac fossa, which is tense, cystic, mobile, non-tender, and not associated with menstrual complaints and ascites. provisional diagnosis, right-sided ovarian tumor, probably benign tumor, but no complications.
Okay. So first, I just want to make a few corrections in your history. Okay. So starting from slide number one, this word that you have used, you know, this navel, that is a word that we don't use in medicine. It is a colloquial term. So we prefer to use the word umbilicus. Okay. So above the umbilicus and below the umbilicus. And number two is you have given the LMP as 21-7-21. I think we have not yet reached the date. Am I correct? Yes. See, you are, a very unlucky batch where you have not seen real patients. So when somebody gives you a history, especially suppose we are going to continue with this corona and you are given a case summary or something, so be very careful regarding what you write. Okay. So have a look at that LMP. And third thing is you have written as family planning done. Now when you talk about family planning, it is not just about sterilization. Okay. It is also, we have so many temporary methods and all that. So I think what you mean is that this lady is sterilized, isn't it? She has undergone a permanent method of contraception. Am I correct? So you have to say patient is sterilized. So FP is a broad term. Okay. Then what is this? Yes. So one more thing is, by the time you finish your history taking, no, and you have examined the patient, you should get an idea regarding what case that is. Okay. So you have given one thing, that is the BMI of the patient is normal. So that is one of the first pointers. She has not lost weight, isn't it? So that is one of the pointers towards the mass, whatever it is, being benign. Okay. One more thing is, you have mentioned the mass to be unilateral. So probably, see, because again, since it is not a real case, one thing that I want to tell all of you regarding the clinical examination, when you are there in your exam, no, suppose you are seeing a real case, let's say that things change, don't go by what the PT there is going to tell you or whoever is around you in the exam hall tells you. You go by only what you actually see and you palpate. That is the best thing to do. Okay. With the examiner, because the examiner may suddenly get up and come and palpate himself or herself and they may find something else. So when you say unilateral, you have gone, usually what I want to convey here is these benign cysts, no, you have given it as a right-sided cystic swelling. But usually, sometimes, most of the times, we may find it in the center. Okay. So it keeps moving. It's also very mobile, no, another pointer towards it being benign. So don't commit on it being right-sided. I'm talking about in case this has been a real case. So examine well, and though most of them are unilateral, don't comment on it unless you really actually feel it really on one side. Okay. Understand what I mean. Mostly it may be in the center. We don't really know on which side it is arising from unless you do a bimanual examination and you feel the pedicle. Suppose it is really on one side, you present it as it is, and in the exam hall, don't go by what others tell you, just by your palpation and your inspection findings alone.
Okay.
Then, okay. Then in any ovarian mass, no, you have commented on the bowel sounds.
Yes.
So you know that one of the difference between benign and malignant is the presence of ascites.
Yes.
Okay, so in malignant, mostly you may have the ascites, isn't it? And so here, when the mass is in the center, the ovarian mass, it is occupying the center, the bowels will tend to go towards the flanks. So you can have one comment there saying that the bowel sounds are well heard in the flanks, because that is what actually happens in ovarian tumors, especially when they are centrally situated. Okay, so these are some of the comments that I have to tell you regarding the history hereafter. Okay. So, why do you need to know whether it is benign or malignant in the first place? Why are we having two separate topics? Can you tell?
Because malignant, it has a short presentation versus in a short span of time.
Okay. More important than that, suppose it is benign.
There is a high chance of turning into malignant.
No, even more important, you have to understand one basic thing. In any woman, no, the main producer of hormones, which defines the femininity or whatever it is the ovary. You can even remove the uterus and throw it away. But removing the ovary is actually a medico-legal thing. You cannot just like that remove anybody's ovary. So that is why even when we do a hysterectomy for a fibroid, till the age of 45, we see to it that the ovaries are retained. Okay. So we have to be very sure what kind of lesion this is. That is why we tend to, and also another important thing is age. As I said, up to the age of 45, this estrogen is very much required for maintaining the integrity of the bones and everything else in a woman. So we cannot just like that remove the, we may the ovary as such. So we may have to go for a conservative therapy also, like cystectomy, etc. And so that at least one ovary is retained, and also the ovarian tissue of the affected site may also be retained. So it is very much necessary to differentiate whether this. We cannot go for radical surgeries, removal of the ovary. The patient may even take you to the court. So you know what is hidden and what is malignant. Okay. So now you proceed with this differential diagnosis before I go on to my slides.
Okay. Differential diagnosis, full bladder, ascites, end-sister tuberculosis, fibroid, pregnancy, myoma, hydronephrosis, mesenteric cyst, enlarged spleen, mucosal of appendix, hiatic cyst.
Okay. So, full bladder. How will you differentiate?
Full bladder, it will be more anterior. It will be fixed and...
Okay. Then, okay, so what I'm trying to tell is this full bladder should not at all be in a differential diagnosis when you're examining, because any gynec case or an obstetric case for that matter, except for a few cases, you have to ask the patient to first go and empty the bladder and come. So in your presentation in the examination also, you have to, when you start any case discussion, after asking the patient to empty the bladder, because this full bladder tends to do a lot of things both in obstetrics and gynec. For example, in obstetrics and fixed head, it can push it up and make it mobile. So your presentation, everything will change. So like that in gynec also, as you said, it may be one of the differential diagnosis. So very simple, you ask the patient to, in case she is having retention of urine, you have to put a catheter and ensure that that is not the bladder. Ascites is the second one. As I told you, if there is ascites, in all probability, it is maybe malignant. Okay. And how does this ascites look like? I think in your Shah, there is a nice diagram of this ovarian cyst, no, enlarged longitudinally in the front. Ascites, you have that woman with flanks being full. Yes. And as I told you, percussion here becomes very important. Okay. Yes. Yeah.
In ascites, the note is dull over the flanks, ma'am. And can it take in the middle? And shifting dullness.
Then what happens in ovarian cyst?
It is dull over the swelling. Whereas resonant in other types.
Okay. Suppose there is an ovarian mass and ascites.
Yes, ma'am.
Then it becomes little difficult. But in a benign, we don't expect that ascites, isn't it? Am I correct?
Yes, ma'am. In a malignant, right, only ascites.
Mm-hmm. Except for a few exceptions. Then fibroid. Yes. Can you tell me? Yes. On palpation, here again we are going to, for ascites, it is percussion. Yes. For fibroid, we go by palpation. Yes.
On palpation, it is solid and it moves only side to side, ma'am.
Okay.
And it is mostly midline.
Okay. Okay. What you're saying is partially correct, but I want to correct you. It is not necessary that the fibroid is one of the most important differential diagnosis of a benign cyst, especially a degenerating fibroid which may have a cystic consistency. Okay. And one more thing is, when you move the mass, you can, when you do a bimanual pelvic examination, when you move the mass, actually the cervix also will move if it is a fibroid. So it is not necessary that the fibroid should be only in the center. It can even be a subserous fibroid which is growing laterally. So even sometimes, even in an ultrasound scan also, we may they give the thing as one of these two, but it turns out to be the other one when we open. So we may have to go for further CT and all that. So fibroid is very important, but a non-degenerated fibroid, as you say, is firm in consistency. And when you move that mass, the cervix also will move. So one of the important, you have spoken up to abdominal examination. After that, in any gyne case, your next step would be, I'll tell you that, upper speculum examination and then a bimanual pelvic examination. Please don't forget that per speculum examination. So per abdominal examination, per speculum, and then what you call as a bimanual pelvic examination. So the third part in obstetrics, where the corresponding one will be a per vaginal examination, whereas in the gynae case it will be a bimanual pelvic examination. What do you mean by bimanual? Two fingers of the right hand, no, with a sterile gloved, two fingers are inside the vagina, and your left hand will be over the abdomen, over the mass. So between these two hands, you will be feeling all the pelvic structures and the masses. Okay. And we will be describing the shape and the mobility, and also you may know whether the mass is moving with the cervix, so that you will know whether it is adnexal or whether it is from the uterus. And apart from that, you can also feel the pedicle of the ovarian cyst and the adnexal masses sometimes. Okay, if it is a long pedicle, you can feel it arising from one of the fornices. So these are all the advantages of a bimanual pelvic examination. And even before that, it's a speculum examination. I really want to emphasize, though it may not be very significant in the case of a benign ovarian cyst, a speculum examination tells you many, many things. So you will be able to visualize the vagina and the cervix. So in case there is any ectropion of the cervix or any abnormal discharge, what type, which may point to a particular infection, if there is any growth in the cervix, all these things, and if there is a polyp arising from within the uterus, all these things can be seen only when you put a speculum. Sometimes polyps may not even be seen in an ultrasound. So speculum examination, important part. After that is the, finally, the bimanual pelvic examination. And even after that is the pararectal examination. Now, can you tell me, your case is a benign ovarian mass, isn't it? So even in a bimanual examination, you are not able to say whether it is from the uterus or from the ovary. So is there anything in the per rectal examination that you can find out? What?
Nodules in the pouch of Douglas.
That is if it is malignant. No, I am asking you, by doing a PR, you want to differentiate between benign and between an uterine and ovarian. What sign is that?
Yes, ma'am, like a furrow,
Not a furrow, a groove.
Groove test.
So the groove test, actually it will be very well felt. Yeah, sometimes not even in a bimanual, in a PR, no? You can feel this groove between a normal uterus and a adnexal mass. Okay, so that is called as a groove sign, to differentiate, to know whether it is arising from the uterus. The uterus may be one small structure, there'll be a groove, and this ovarian mass, no, sometimes it will be sitting over the uterus. This part you can feel very well in the PR. Okay. Right. Okay. Hydronephrosis. Okay. Hydronephrosis, what exactly do you mean? Why do you put it in a differential diagnosis? What happens to this benign cyst? Can they grow extra peritoneally?
No, ma'am.
It can't grow. It is one of the complications, actually. Okay. So probably at that time you may mistake it for something arising from the kidney.
Okay.
And pregnancy?
Ma'am, pregnancy actually, like ectopic pregnancy, like that, it could also.
No. We are talking about a big mass. Yours is 11x8. So ectopic pregnancy doesn't come into the picture at all, very simply because mostly it turns out to be something acute. So ectopic pregnancy doesn't present as such a big mass at all. So what they mean is, actually, one of the first presenting complaints of a woman with any ovarian mass, no, is a vague sensation of what you described first, a vague sensation of probably a fullness, a pain in the lower abdomen, or mainly a distension. Okay. So sometimes she keeps thinking that it is just fat, she is growing fat or something. and then she ignores. Then when we do a scan, we find this out. So like that, the same lady, especially when she is sterilized, she may think that it is a cyst, but it may turn out to be pregnancy. But obviously, beyond 5 months, we do come across cases where they say they just don't know that they are pregnant. Okay. Especially when they are sterilized and it turns out to be a sterilization failure and all that. But after 5 months, what happens? We do find it out because the movements of the fetus begins. So till then, she thinks that it is something else. So I think we shouldn't be missing pregnancy as such. But there, what will be there? This patient is not having that. In pregnancy, what will be? So this lady is not amenorrheic. A pregnant lady mostly know the first thing she comes to you is when she misses her periods. So that is not there in your history here. So like that you rule it out. Okay. So regarding your management, what are the things that you would like to do? Apart from the routine investigations you have written. Right. So in an ultrasound, what are the things that you will see?
For benign and malignant, different type of benign, it is anechoic, unilocular, or maybe multilocular with a thin septa is found.
Size of the septa?
Less than 5 millimeters.
Okay. Then?
In malignant,
not able to hear. 1 minute, Pavitra, hold on. She's not audible. Pavitra, she's speaking, but it's not audible. Yes, now I'm able to hear.
Yes, ma'am. Oh, sorry, ma'am. Actually,
Okay, no problem. Okay, so you have spoken about the ultrasound features. Then, what is
that?
Continue, ma'am.
There is a multilocular cyst with thick septa, more than 5 millimeter thickness.
Okay.
And there is increased vascularity in the
body. Wait a minute. How do you actually look at vascularity anywhere in the body?
Doppler.
Yes. So Doppler is an extension of ultrasound. So by doing a Doppler, when you see increased vascularity, maybe one of the features of malignancy. Then next.
When size is more than 10 centimeters, most likely it is malignant.
No, you're wrong. Mostly, no. The benign ones, like mucinous cyst adenoma, it is so huge. Sometimes it occupies the entire abdomen, but then it turns out to be benign. Okay. So, actually speaking, the benign ones can attain very big size, especially all of you know. You must have seen the picture of the lady with mucinous cyst adenoma, where the entire abdomen is, generally distended, and it turns out to be a very big scene. You saw, there will be a picture. Okay, so that by size we cannot say, by other things only, that is fixity, lack of mobility, all those things only we will be able to say whether clinically, and the presence of ascites, these are the things that may point towards the malignancy rather than the size. Okay, then IVP fine, because you should know whether the ureters are compressed in any way, especially when you are going to do a surgery, so that you don't injure them. Then CT and MRI we do to delineate the structures better. As I told you, sometimes fibroid and ovarian cyst, even by a normal ultrasound, they may give a different picture. So CT and MRI will tell you exactly from where it is arising and what is the size and the consistency and all those things. Then tumor markers, yes, very, very important. So can you tell me something about this?
More than 35 units per
hour. Okay, now from which sort of a tumor does the CA-125 come from?
Epithelial tumor.
epithelial tumors. Okay. So, can you tell me some? It is raised usually in malignancy, and can you tell me some non-malignant condition where the CA-125 is raised? Non-malignant ovarian conditions. Yes. So it may. Okay. So endometriosis is another common condition where it may be raised. So where do we use it? Now we are talking about benign. So we just do it to ensure that there is no associated malignancy. Okay. So if it is under normal range, it is one of the another pointers towards it being benign. Now what about these other things? AFP, HCG, LDH and all that. No, rather than saying like that, let us say that if these things are raised and you also have an ovarian mass, probably they are germ cell tumors. Okay. So it doesn't tell us about benign malignancy, but it tells us that probably they are germ cell tumors. Okay. So X-ray chest. Right. Go to the next one, ma. Next slide. That's all. Okay. Can I have my slides? Okay, so most of the things you have discussed, let me just, actually what I have put is all from your show only. I just thought because you people are not coming, it is all virtual. So I thought probably all looked into the screen and maybe just, you know, we can go through this. So by history, as you have said, it is mostly not related to age or parity. It can be that at any age, and I am talking only about benign. So there is no pain, okay, no menstrual disorder as you said. She's having, your patient is having regular periods. What are the exceptions to a person with a ovarian mass with menstrual disorder? So where can you have a menstrual disorder? So as I put it up on the screen, feminizing ovarian tumors. There you can have, it can either be as a abnormal uterine bleeding can be there in a reproductive age group. In a postmenopausal bleeding, postmenopausal woman, if she's having postmenopausal bleeding along with the ovarian mass, so that can be a feminizing ovarian tumor. So that is one of the exceptions where the menstrual abnormalities may be there, right? So as you generally say, in a benign cyst or a benign mass, there is no pain. Now, where can you have a excruciating severe pain in a benign ovarian tumor? One of the most common that comes in complication, but I would like to say that if there is a sudden hemorrhage into the cyst, or the most important one which we see very often is torsion. When it undergoes torsion, what happens? The pedicles, no, they get twisted and the blood supply is cut off. That time it becomes an emergency, surgical emergency, and we have to go open her up and we have to remove that cyst. Okay, so it is a surgical emergency torsion. So that time she can have pain. So these are some of the exceptions. And by examination, you have already described, mostly they are unilateral, several times cystic only, well-defined and mobile. So when you see a real case, you will find that it is really like a balloon. When you push it from side to side, no, it goes into the abdomen from here and there, it keeps going like a balloon. So when you see a real case, you will be able to appreciate that. So usually there is no ascites except in Meek syndrome. Okay, what is Meek syndrome? Pavitra, are you there?
Yes, ma'am, I'm there.
What is Meek syndrome? All this is in pathology, I think. Where do you see that? So, in a fibroma of the ovary, you may have. Okay. Ascites is associated, but that doesn't mean that it is a malignant one. So, we are talking about some exceptions. Right. So usually, as you said, nodules in PR, you said. So when it is benign, no nodules are found in the abdomen or in the pouch of Douglas when you do a PV or PR. Okay. So when you do an ultrasound, mostly it is cystic. Sometimes internal echoes may be there, sometimes not. No ascites. Doppler, there is no increased vascularity. And MRI and CT, they will just, you know, say whether the ultrasound features are correct or not. Okay. So here, the symptom-wise, I just want to tell you that it is a very sad thing that many of these ladies who come with stage 4 ovarian cancer and all that, they, at least, you know, those days when people were not doing ultrasound so often, they used to go to the doctor. And I'm sorry to say, sometimes male doctors, no, because you people forget OG the moment you finish the final year. Okay. So there is no role for inspection as far as our doctors are concerned after they pass OG and go. So what happens? This lady goes and she keeps telling about some vague symptoms in the abdomen. She feels fullness and all that. So you just end up giving some antacid and all that and sending her home. And then what happens? One fine day, it becomes, things become bad. And when you do an ultrasound and all that, and when you do a laparotomy, you find that it is stage 4. So what I'm trying to tell is, ovarian is very, very silent and deadly. Okay, so never miss that. See, when there is a CA of the endometrium, it will present as abnormal bleeding. CA cervix, no need to say at all. We have so many screening methods, pap smear and via villi and all, and it is outside the body, so it is easily seen. But ovary is very deadly. So make it a point never to miss on the palpation, and probably a what do you say, at least once a year a woman should undergo a ultrasound, because it is indispensable. So people say doctors do a lot of investigations, not necessary, but those days have gone by. So when you do a, at least once a year, when you do a, as a part of a routine checkup, when you do an ultrasound, probably you will be able to pick up things early, because it is a silent and deadly malignancy of the ovary. Okay. So in the menstrual cycle, mostly not affected, as you told in your history. So menorrhagia can be there in, not menorrhagia, the term we use now is heavy menstrual bleed. Only in granulosa and theca cell tumors, and you may have amenorrhea and visualization in masculinizing tumors, and postmenopausal bleeding may be there in benign Brenner and feminizing tumor. Then comes the pressure symptoms. Naturally, our friend in the front, OG's friend in the front, is the urinary bladder. So it may press on the bladder, and another important thing is patient may even present with dyspnea. Okay, because of the, when it goes upwards, I told you some of them are so huge, they occupy the whole abdomen, they may press on the diaphragm, leading to dyspnea and palpitation. Then there may be pressure on the great vessels. So this patient may also have bilateral pitting edema of the feet. I think you did not mention that in your history, am I correct?
I mean, in general exam,
Okay. So if you have told, it's fine, that this is the significance, bilateral pitting edema because of the pressure on the vessels. Then as I told you, pain may or may not be there. Now pain may be of some types. One is this abdominal discomfort because of the huge size. Apart from that, as I told you, distortion, then rupture, hemorrhage, all those things. And the person who comes with a torsion of the ovary, maybe a young person also. So what all does she have? She has acute pain, she has vomiting, then she will be in shock. So naturally the pulse will be thready, feeble, and it will be a high pulse rate. And when you palpate the abdomen, it will be tense and tender. And a dermatitis may become infected, that time the patient may have pain and fever. Okay, so physical signs, inspection, abdominal swelling, and symmetrically situated, as I told you, you said on the right side, but probably, you know, whether it's right or left, it may go to the center, and it may be longitudinally, one mass would be sitting there. Then palpation, you have already told, the upper and lateral margins are well defined. The lower bottom may not be palpable because it is inside the pelvis. So bimanual examination, you may be able to feel the pedicle. So the surface in benign tumors, mostly they are smooth, mobile. Okay, unless they are too big where you cannot move them at all, then consistency is mostly tense and cystic. And since it is filled with fluid, the fluid thrill may be present. And sometimes due to the loculi, you may have hard ache. See, in medicine, just remember that everything is not in black and white. There are a lot of gray areas. You have to keep your mind open for that also. What I mean is, we talk, we say that there are no doesn't feel hard, isn't it? But there may be variations. So you have to correlate your clinical finding, your ultrasound and everything, and then only come to a conclusion. So there may be hard areas even in a benign tumor. Then ascites, as I told you, except in weeks, in benign it is not present. Then percussion, it is dull over the center, that is over the mass, because mostly it is in the center, and resonant in the flanks due to the displaced bowels. Then comes the bimanual pelvic examination. Small tumors, you can feel well between your two hands, the abdominal hand and the pelvic hand. Then large tumors, we can only probably feel the lower pole. You cannot feel the whole thing and say this is of this size and shape and all that. And as I told you, delineation of the uterus. When the ovarian tumor is raised by the abdominal hand, you can feel the cervix. But in ovarian tumor, the cervix, if it's a fibroid, the cervix also will be pulled up. But in an ovarian tumor, it will not be pulled up. Only the mass will go up. Then PR examination, I already told you, groove sign will be present, and hard nodules in case it is malignant. Differential diagnosis already you have told, so I'm not going into it. So obesity, what I want to here emphasize again is, if the woman says she feels that her abdomen has swollen, and then she feels some heaviness, please palpate and also do an ultrasound, because obesity also is one of the differential diagnoses. Yes. Okay. So in the ultrasound, the transvaginal approach is preferred, especially for small tumors, because transvaginal ultrasound, when you do it, is the probe is going close to all the structures in the pelvis. Especially if there is obesity, you know, the transabdominal may not give you a clear picture. So transvaginal, always for any pelvic pathology, if you want to see, you can go for the transvaginal, right? Doppler, you have already touched on that. CT and MRI, better differentiation, and also to find out the type, consistency. Tumor markers also you have already touched upon. So coming to the management, mostly for all the benign tumors, we go for surgery. Okay, so we may like to make it as conservative as possible. So suppose she is beyond the age of 45, let us say, and this decision, I want to make it very clear, is not taken by the doctor. The decision is actually taken by the patient always. The role of the doctor before going for surgery is to take an informed consent. Okay. So most of the ladies don't think that everybody will shake their head and say, she may say, no doctor, even if I'm 45, I want to retain my uterus, to remove only my ovary because you're telling me it is benign. Then you have to do that only. But you can explain to her and tell her that the uterus is only a bag. The one she has delivered her children, after that, it is just, you know, every month she gets a period, sometimes too much of it, and it creates. So tomorrow something arises from that also. So you can tell her that the ovaries are always there, she has to keep on doing a scan. So you can tell, after the age of 45, you can go for the abdominal hysterectomy and bilateral salpingo-oophorectomy in a perimenopausal woman. Now, actually speaking, what is so oophorectomy and what is ovariotomy? Parita, can you tell? No problem, because we are here to tell you only. Actually, oophorectomy means it is removal of a normal ovary. Okay, ovariotomy is removal of a diseased ovary. So actually, the second term is the correct one. So for a younger woman, where you want to retain, you can do a cystectomy also, where you remove only the cyst. Or if it is too big, you are not able to conserve the ovarian tissues for what it is worth, then you go for ovariotomy. Okay. And usually we have read just now that it is unilateral. So we try to conserve the other ovary. It is very, very important, especially when she wants to retain where the children, you need those follicles. Apart from that, you also need the estrogen. Okay. So here, just a small thing I want to tell. Nowadays, laparoscopy is the in thing, because you don't cut across the rectus, the muscle and everything. So the integrity of the abdominal wall is maintained. That is the main advantage of the laparoscopy. But there are some conditions, especially in malignancies and also in the benign, you know, you have the dermoid cyst and mucinous cyst, you know, you don't want the contents to spill. causing peritonitis or the pseudomyxoma peritonei. So to avoid these two conditions, in these two benign tumors alone, probably you would like to go for the open method and remove it en masse. Okay. Right. Okay. So this is another small thing to touch upon. The ovarian tumors in pregnancy. Sometimes you may have this corpus luteal cyst in a pregnancy, early pregnancy. You need not bother about it. After the 12th week, it will go off by itself. And in case of these benign tumors, you want to do a surgery on these people, then the right time to do it during pregnancy would be the second trimester, between the 14th and the 16th week. And suppose you have discovered it late, towards term, then you have to do it in early puberty. Okay, so with this I'll stop. And all those things that I have put here and most of the things that you have told is there in your shops. So you please read up that book. Somebody told me your seniors that she has gone through this, what is that? Another one, Lakshmi. Please go through the Shah. Actually, the gynec Shah is, I think, more than enough and it touches upon almost everything. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. What about this attendance? How do you actually...
We will take it from this app, ma'am, and then we are updating in an Excel sheet and sending to registrar.